Hello friends, we will be covering the following: electrical property, classification of semiconductors, valency bond, model of semiconductors, energy band, distinction between conductor, insulator, semiconductors on the basis of band theory, and then we'll have intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductors, n-type and p-type, mobility of charge carriers, electrical conductivity of a semiconductor. We assume that there is a large number of almost free electrons in a conductor which wander randomly in the whole of the conductor, whereas all the electrons in an insulator are tightly bound to some nucleus or the other. Semiconductors, to conduct electricity when an electric field is applied, but the conductivity is very small as compared to the usual metallic conductor. Silicon is an example of semiconductor. Its conductivity is 10 to the power 11 times smaller than that of the copper. In semiconductor, the conductivity increases with increase in temperature. So when we increase the temperature, conductivity increases. Hence, we can say semiconductor is a combination of both conductor and insulator. We can control, the main property is that we can control the conductivity. So we will see that as we will see the P and N type. Current I here, just noting down a formula, current I is equal to NEAVD, this formula that you are aware of. What is N? N is the variation in charge carrier. So if we have this variation, then we can control the conductivity in a semiconductor. The range of resistivity, conductivity, for conductor, insulator and semiconductor is given here, that if you want, you can note it down. The semiconductor that we will mainly study in this chapter will be silicon. So the main element that we'll be studying will be silicon. Though we have divided, this classification is basically on the two parts, compound and element. In compound, we can divide it into two parts like organic and inorganic. Under organic, we can say non-polymer and polymer. Polymer can be further divided into polyanisiline and polythiophylline. So these are the classification of semiconductors. But main conductor that we will be studying will be silicon right now. Every electron has a binding energy. Silicon has 4 electrons in the outermost shell. At the time of pairing, an electron takes turn around another nucleus. Semiconductors, pure semiconductors, conductivity is due to intrinsic charge carrier and not impurity. We don't add impurity. If we add impurity, it will become extrinsic. But for this particular silicon, we will say it is this pure one will be an intrinsic charge carrier. So if you look here in the outer shell from the silicon, this is the atom model silicon. We have 2 electrons and then we have 8 and in the outermost we have 4. Because of this 4, we are going to see the covalent bond structure, that how its pairing is done. Suppose here, if you see this silicon, it has got 1, 2, 3, 4 of its own, but it is sharing the electron of the other as well. So we are going to see that through in the coming up video. This is how the structure is. Like, this is the silicon. The outermost is being shown here, that it has got 1, 2, 3, 4 electrons around it. Okay. Let me play this. How this animation just showing you the outer, how they are moving. This is how the electrons are moving around the silicon. One silicon atom, these are the electrons moving around. The outermost shell has got 4 electrons. Okay, coming on to the covalent bond. Now, trying to explain you the covalent bond. Suppose that structure of silicon has got 4 in the outermost structure. So 1, 2, 3, 4 is its own and it has a covalent sharing with the other. This is from this silicon. This is being shared. So to make it 8, when it becomes 8 in the outermost, then the silicon electron, the atom is stable. every electron has a binding energy. Silicon has 4 electrons in last orbit. At the time of pairing, an electron takes turn around another nucleus. So this is just showing you how it takes turn around the other nucleus. So this formation is the covalent bonding. Pure semiconductors conductivity is due to intrinsic charge that we have talked about. Silicon has 4 valence electrons, which it shares with 4 nearest neighboring atoms to form 4 covalent bonds. The shared pair of electrons oscillates back and forth between the 2 associated atoms. An electron may break away from the covalent bond and become free to conduct electricity. That we are going to see how it can break away and form the electricity. This electron leaves behind a valency in the covalent bond, and this valency is called a hole. In deep, we are going to study what is a hole and how this free electron can carry the electricity. Or in other terms, we can say a covalent bond is a molecular bond or a chemical bond that involves sharing of electron pairs between atoms. So in between the atoms, this is being shared. It's a sharing. These electron pair are known as shared pairs or bonding pairs. This stable balance of attractive and repulsive forces between atoms when they share electrons is known as covalent bonding. So we have learned that every electron has a binding energy. So silicon has 4 electrons in the last orbit. At the time of pairing, an electron takes turn around another nucleus. So that is shown here to you. This is how it is taking the turn. Electrons are rotating around the nucleus and also around nucleus to form pairing. This bonding is called covalent bonding. So let me show you in a animation here exactly how the bonding is taking place. See, look here. This is, suppose we zoom into, this is a silicon. This is how the pairing is going on. It is being shared. So at a point, there can be 8 electrons. So this bonding that you see, this bonding is called covalent bonding. So I hope this helps you with the animation. Let's come on to the other slide. Energy levels, okay, energy band. If an electron is not making a valence bond, if it's not making a valence bond, it is free. So we call it free electron. It is free from valency work. As soon as we apply electric field, a force of how much value? Force equals to charge into electric field is generated. The formula is F is equal to QE. Okay, this is generated on electron and it starts moving. This makes electric current to flow. So we understand that the electron with less energy does the work of valency. So if it does has less energy, it's going to be the part of the covalent bond where it is doing the bonding work. The electron with more energy does the work of electricity and they don't do the work of valency. If they are doing the work of conductivity, the electricity, then they are not doing the work of covalent bonding. We can draw the level of energy. Say this is energy versus the interatomic space in a graphical form. Here, if you see, if it has got less energy, then it is doing the work of a valency bond. If this has got more energy, it is doing the work of the conduction. So graph is divided into 3 parts. Valency band, this is the valency band. Then we have conduction band, this is the conduction band. And this is called the energy gap band. So E gap. Okay, so we represent EV. So this is the valency band and this is the E minimum, which is the energy minimum. This is the line is the minimum energy required for the conduction. So this is the conductivity bond, conduction band. Okay. I hope this graph is clear to you. The energy band fitted with valence electron is called valence band. The energy band fitted with valency electron is called valence band. They are doing the work of valency only. So the electrons which are doing the work of valency only, valency means bonding, So that is electron in the last orbit are pairing in turn around another nucleus. So it's rotating around another nucleus. So they are called valency. They are filling the valency. It is denoted by the symbol EV and have less energy level. Hence in this graph, they are shown here in the bottom. The conduction band have higher energy level and do the work of conductivity denoted by EC. So they are going to do the conductivity. The gap between top of the valency band and bottom of the conduction, this gap in between is called energy gap. Here please note, no electron of any energy level exist, denoted by the symbol EG. Now what happens in case of conductors? See, the same graph we are representing here in form of conductors. The metal who do conductivity, what is happening for the energy level gap to them? The conduction band and the valence band are overlapping. If you see, these two bands are overlapping. There is no gap here between EG. A large number of conduction electrons are present in conduction band. So there will be a lot of electrons which are going to be present here. And conductivity of metal will be very high. So there will be less electrons here in EV part. These both are overlapping and there will be lot of electrons in this part, which is the EC band. What happens in case of insulators and semiconductors for this energy band graph? Let's have a look here. Insulators. So this is for the insulator. Now for the insulator, a large energy gap of more than, what is the gap value? EG is more than 3 EV. So this gap is more than 3 EV between the two bands. No free electrons or holes are present in the conductivity. If you see, there are no holes or electrons are present in the conductivity of a substance is zero, almost zero. All the electrons are doing the work in valency. So they are doing the bonding work. That is why this is the, for the insulation, they are not allowing conductivity. EC is almost empty. Okay, here we come on to semiconductors. In case of semiconductors, if you notice this E gap, this is smaller than this gap. So EG is less than 3 EV. For insulator, this gap is more than 3 EV. Here the gap is less than 3 EV. So the energy level gap is smaller than insulator, that is smaller than 3 EV. At room temperature, EC band is partially filled. So if you see, there are few, one or two or three. At a temperature other than absolute zero, few free electrons are present in conduction bands. And as the temperature increases, when we are increasing the temperature, the electrons in EC band increases in conductivity. So they are going to increase. When the temperature increases, the electrons will, free electrons will increase here and it will become a conductor, kind of a conductor. Better from the semiconductor, they are going to have little conductivity here. Now explaining you the term intrinsic semiconductors and extrinsic semiconductors. Intrinsic semiconductors are pure semiconductors material. And they have no impurity of any sort. The electrical conductivity is generally small and the electrical conductivity depends on temperature here. For extrinsic semiconductors are prepared by doping. What does the word doping means? Adding some other impurity, a small quantity of impurity of pentavalent or trivalent material to the pure semiconducting material is added. The electrical conductivity is comparatively high and main function of mainly depends on the function of how much amount of doping has been done, how much impurity has been added. So we are going to understand these terms as well. So if it is intrinsic semiconductor, means it's a pure, then it will be like a silicon. Okay, just silicon. Now we are going to look into the extrinsic semiconductors because we are going to develop P and N type from extrinsic semiconductors. Now coming on to understanding the atomic structure of phosphorus. Okay, let us understand the atomic structure of phosphorus. It has 5 electrons in the outermost outer surface. Okay, outermost shell, it has 5 electrons, means one more than silicon. So silicon has 4. So phosphorus has 5. So here phosphorus has 5. Let's have a look here. See the structure 1, 2, 3, 4 and the 5th. So phosphorus has 5. And if we see the outermost, it's like 1, 2, 3, 4 and this is the extra one, 5. So phosphorus has 5 electrons. What happens? Let's play the animation. This is how they are rotating in a atomic structure of a phosphorus. N-type is an extrinsic semiconductor. It has an impurity element, phosphorus, in it. Silicon covalent bond is represented here, that you can see right now. Notice in this animation that I'm going to play now, if one phosphorus is added, then the silicon makes covalent bond, but an electron is allowed to move freely as phosphorus has an extra electron because phosphorus has 5 electron in the outermost shell. Similarly, if more phosphorus is added, then more free electrons can be seen. This is therefore called N-type. The electrons are majority charge carriers here. Here, the free electron density is much more greater. Let's have a look by playing this animation. One silicon moves out, adding the impurity of phosphorus. Phosphorus has got 5, one is moved freely. Similarly, if we add more phosphorus, then more negativity and more negative electrons are circulating around. This is N-type. We are studying the atomic structure of boron. In case of boron, it only has 3 electrons in the outer shell. As compared to silicon, one electron is less. A hole is present in the outer shell. Instead of having 4, it has got only 3. So only 3 are occupied, one is empty. Okay, so this you can see a ring-like structure, it represents a hole to you. This is atomic structure of boron. What happens, we are going to see once we add this boron as an impurity in a pure silicon. It will become extrinsic but a p-type. Let's have a look. So before I play this animation, trying to explain you, p-type is an extrinsic semiconductor with impurity that we are going to add now is boron. Here the covalent bond is not complete because boron has only 3 electrons in the outer shell. So to fill the electron space, the nearby electron starts moving. Notice the hole are majority charges here, while the electrons are minority charges here. The hole density is much greater than the free electron density. So let me play here. What we are doing, instead of one silicon, it's going to be replaced by one boron for right now. And then you will see how from one nearby electron, it will move into the empty space, the empty hole here. The electron is going to shift. So this is will be p-type. Just a second. If you play this L-silicon, boron being replaced, and this is being, the place is being taken by, the holo space is being taken by the nearby electron. Okay, I hope this was helpful to you to understand the p-type and n-type. When we compare the n-type and p-type semiconductors, so semiconductors you have understood, if it is intrinsic, it is pure, which has got only silicon in it. When it extrinsic, in extrinsic we can add group 5 elements. If impurity group 5, then let's we have seen in case phosphorus was added, what happens? It becomes n-type. In case boron was added, it becomes p-type. So n-type semiconductors are obtained by doping. Doping means adding impurity atom of group 5. The impurity atom added provide free electron. and are called donors. So these will be called as donors. The impurity atom added provide free electrons. The donor impurity level lie just below the conduction band. The n-type, the electron are majority charge carrier, while hole is minority charge carrier. The valency or absence of electron in the bond of a covalent bonded crystal is called a hole. So I hope you understand the term hole. When the electron is absent, that is called a hole. Now, in p-type, the hole are majority charge. While electrons are minority charge carriers, the p-type semiconductors are obtained by doping impurity atoms, such as we have added boron. We have just seen an animation for that. These are called acceptors. The impurity level just above the valency bond. Okay. Now, in this, if you see this part, okay, look, have a look at this. This is P and this is N. It is a single crystal of silicon which is doped. Doped means impurity added. In such a manner that one half portion of it acts as p-type and the other half acts as n-type. So this is a semiconductor here. Junction implies the boundary or region of transmission. This will be called as the junction here. p-n type is also called diode. So other name for p-n type is diode. This allows the electric current in only one direction while blocks the electric current in opposite or reverse direction, which we are going to see in depth how the directions of the electron and holes are going to move here. We also know in p-type holes are majority carriers. So if you see, these are representing you, the rings are representing you the holes. And in n-type electrons, these dots are representing you the electrons. So electrons are the majority carrier, as we notice in this picture that you can see clearly. The graph here, this graph is showing you the forward biasing and reverse biasing that in the coming up video we are going to discuss further. Let's understand this that we have covered here, this part, one more time. Okay. The distribution of charge near the junction is shown in this picture. This negative charge gets accumulated in P region. See, this you can see the negative charge is getting accumulated here in the P junction. The positive charge in N region sets up a potential difference across the junction. This acts as a barrier. So this positive and negative acts as a barrier and it is called barrier potential. This layer is also called, this center layer is also called depletion layer. Positive and negative. So this is positive and negative. The diffusion of majority charge carrier across the junction give rise to electric current from P to N and is called diffusion current. Okay. So here, I hope this is understandable. This is P and this part is N. When they are put together, so some of the holes and electron, just when they are absolutely together, so they are going to club in here, hole and negative. So here this becomes the depletion layer. Okay. And then the charge is zero here and it is called the depletion layer, which is going to form on one side a potential barrier, negative and positive. So potential barrier is formed here. So let me explain you through an animation, that way it will become clear to you. So the moment P and N are brought together, some of the electrons from N are going to move this side and from the hole P are going to move in the center. This center will become the depletion layer where they are going to be joined together and the electric field is going to be developed on the two corners. Let's have a look again. We are going to look into an animation where the concept for n-type region and p-type region will be more clear. what we are basically doing here is that we are bringing n-type region and p-type region together. A diffusion current due to the opposite neighboring coming close will be formed here in stage 1. And in stage 2, there will be current flow due to minority. So we are going to look into this animation and understand how exactly PNN junction work. So two important processes involved during the formation of PNN junction are diffusion and drift. When PNN junction is formed, P side has higher concentration of holes while N side has higher concentration of electrons. So if you see this negative, these are the electrons. These ring-like structure is showing you that these has got higher holes. Now holes begin the moment they are put together. When PN junction is formed and they are put together as neighbors. So holes begin to diffuse with from P to N, and electrons begin to diffuse from N to P in the center. Let me play this animation for you to see this part. Here they start to diffuse. This is the depletion layer being formed. Okay, so once this depletion layer is formed, then as holes diffuse from P to N, they leave behind a negative acceptor ion, which sets up a layer of negative charge. Similarly, a layer is formed of positive charge on the N side of the junction. So here, the positive layer will be formed. Here, the negative layer will be formed. As the hole diffuses from P to N, they leave behind negative acceptor ions. So which sets up a layer of negative charge here. So in the P type, a negative layer has been set up. All the electrons near the junction are pushed by the electric field towards the P side. This middle part becomes the depletion layer. So here there is an electric field that has been developed. Now stage 2. Now in stage 2, conductivity has reduced. Why it has reduced? Because this layer is really making that gap so big that they cannot attract each other as neighbors. So conductivity has reduced, diffusion is closed. Now electric field is developed across this junction. So the junction negative has been developed. In the N type, this positive here, a potential barrier has been developed. Since this depletion layer potential tends to prevent, it is stopping the movement of electrons from N to P region. It is called potential barrier. As the potential gap is large, when the gap is very large, this yellow line that you can see, the gap is very large. The majority, what is the majority? So here in the N type, it was the electrons. They are stuck. The majority are stuck. That is holes from PN junction. And the electrons from the N junction are not able to diffuse. Here, what happens? The electric field which has been developed across this line. Here, there is an electric field developed and there is a electric field developed here. So, the negative ions here and the positive ions here, they are forming the potential barrier, and electric field is developed that this will support the minority charges. Now it is going to support the minority charges. So what are the minority charges in P-type? So if you see, P-type has positive, which are the holes in it. Okay, so it has got a vacancy here. So it has got holes here. So what are the minority here? The minorities are small electrons, very less quantity of electrons in P-type. And similarly, here it is mainly N-type has got negative electrons here, but the minority are small. There are some amount of holes, very less holes here. because of this electric field in between that has been developed. This is stage 2, where the current will flow due to the minority. So what happens here, an electric field is developed that supports the minority charge, that are electrons in p-type. There are few electrons in p-type and holes in n-type which will be allowed to flow. The minority will allow the current to flow. So let me recapture everything here one more time. So what has happened? Here the conductivity has reduced, diffusion has closed after in stage 2, electric field is developed across the junction. Since this depletion layer potentials tends to prevent the movement of electron from the n region to the p region, this is called potential barrier. Electric field is developed, potential is equal to electric field into the distance in between. Majority is stuck up due to large gap or resistivity, or you say opposite potential difference created. Now only the minority charges, they have got an advantage of the electric field. So electric field minority charge carriers can flow easily. So it was in the main thing was, it was the first step was, first was diffusion current due to opposite neighboring coming closer. Then what happens, the second part is, the second stage is due to minority charge, little more current flows. Okay, little more current will flow through due to the minority charges. So I hope this was helpful to you. Thank you.